Good morning, everyone. Oh, it's pretty spooky driving in here today, huh? Ooh, almost Halloween. Hey, I'm Pastor Michael, and I want to welcome you to St. Matthew, all of those who are members, guests, all of those of you who are live streaming today. It's good to have you in worship as we continue our red letter challenge. And this week, we are on giving. So we're going to hear from God's word on that in just a little bit. But in the meantime, I invite you to stand as we begin, and we call upon the name of our God, as we always do, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Praise the Lord. The Lord's name be praised. Great God, you have been generous and marvelously kind. Give us such wonder, love, and gratitude that we may sing praises to you and joyfully honor your name. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Will you pray with me? Lord, open our hearts and minds by the power of your Holy Spirit, that we may hear your word with joy. Amen. We invite you to be seated. Thank you. A special thank you to our middle school choir. Thank you for using your gifts and spending the time and worshiping with us today. Amazing job. Our first scripture reading today is from Malachi chapter 3, verse 10. Bring the whole tithe into the storehouse, that there may be food in my house. Test me in this, says the Lord Almighty, and see if I will not throw open the floodgates of heaven and pour out so much blessing that there will not be room enough to store it. Our gospel reading is from Luke chapter 21, and in honor and love of the person and work of Jesus Christ, I invite you to stand. As Jesus looked up, he saw the rich putting their gifts into the temple treasury. And he also saw a poor widow who put in two very small copper coins. Truly, I tell you, he said, this poor widow has put in more than all the others. All these people gave their gifts out of their wealth, but she gave out of her poverty and put in all she had to live on. This is our gospel reading. We invite you to be seated. And at this point in our worship, we want to invite all the kids to come on up and Miss Dawn Roop as well.
Wasn't it? You guys, I can't tell you how excited I am to see all of you here today. So we get to talk about giving. Okay. Now I know a lot of times, come on, you guys. A lot of times it's easy for us, if I would ask you, and I just want you to think it in your mind, what's the best present you ever got? You might have to sort through a few, but we can remember those kinds of things, right? But I'm going to ask you a different question. What's the best thing you ever gave somebody? What's your favorite thing you ever gave? I know a lot of times if you make something in class for mom or dad, or somebody has a birthday and you're really excited to give what you have for them, it's a lot of fun. So can you think of anything that was really fun to give? I know I get excited when I know my boys are gonna like some of the stuff that I'm giving them. Well, we're talking about giving it a really good time, aren't we? Because what did we do last night and what's coming up? A lot of us did last night. And then what's coming up next weekend? What holiday is coming up? Halloween. And it's all about, yep, trunk or treat. And you know, that's just giving, right? Well, for you guys, it's getting, right? But when else do you get to go around neighborhoods and knock on people's door and say, can I have some? Right? I mean, that's what trick or treat means, right? It's, hey, can I have some of the good stuff I know you have in your house? We don't ever get, I don't just walk over to my neighbor usually and knock on their door and say, hey, what do you got in there? Can I have some? That would be crazy, right? People wouldn't like me as a neighbor, would they? No. But you know what? It's so fun. It's fun to get that stuff, but it's really fun to give. I love standing in my house or out at my trunk and seeing all of you guys come all dressed up, and it's fun. And you know what, though? You know who's the best giver ever? No, not me. I wish I was. I would love that. But thanks for thinking so. It is Jesus. That's right. It's, yeah, God gives and gives. You can't outgive Jesus, no matter how much we give. And you know what? That is why we can feel good about giving to other people. God gives blessings to us so that we can also bless other people, you know? And it's really exciting when God uses us that way. So sometimes we get to be on the receiving end, but sometimes it's really fun when we get to be on the giving end. Did you know, have you ever been in a car line with your mom or dad, like at Tim Hortons for a donut or something, and you pull up and mom or dad's ready to pay and you hear, oh, the car in front of you paid for you. Sometimes that happens, right? Have you ever had that happen? It's always a nice little treat, isn't it? Well, a lot of times that car will say, oh, well, then I'll pay for the car behind me. Do you know the longest chain of that happening was 900 cars long at a Dairy Queen, which is always great, right? Free Dairy Queen. But it was such a big deal that there were people calling Dairy Queen saying, if there's a car that can't pay, here, put this on a gift card and you can use it for them. So people sometimes really get into giving. And here at church, we are into giving, right? The choir just gave us a beautiful song and we're going to get a message this morning and we get other beautiful music. And you know what? We get to be here together. You're giving your time and some of us are giving sleep, right? To be here together, right? But you know what? Another thing, we give money and that helps the church's mission. And you know what? If you have a dollar, do you know what God has asked for out of that dollar? He says 10%. Do you know what 10% of a dollar is? It's one dime. So Jesus doesn't even ask for a ton. He says, give me some of your time. Give me some of the beautiful talents and use those for other people. And you know what? When I give you gifts that you know are money, give that back too so that we can use it to bless other people. And you know what? Sometimes that's hard, right? When you get money, we don't always want to share because we don't get a lot of money all the time. And you know what? Even as an adult, I have a hard time with that because I have three boys to feed. Do you know how much three boys eat? Oh my goodness. Yeah, a lot. And so sometimes I'm like, God, I only have this much money. And he says, you know what? Be faithful. Because is he always going to outgive what I can give? Yeah, I can be a pretty good giver sometimes, but God is still going to be better. And so we thank him for always taking care of us, okay? And remember, when you worry about it, you can't outgive God. God will always be given to us, okay? Let's pray together. Jesus, thank you so much for being the best giver. You gave your son, first of all, and that's the best gift. But then you keep giving to us, Lord, and you always will, and we're so thankful. Help us to take some of that and to see when someone needs us to turn around and give to them, whether it's our time or our money or the gifts that you've given us, Lord. We are so thankful that we have opportunities to share with other people. Help us to see when those come and help us to be thankful for all the things you give us. In your name we pray. Amen. Thanks for coming up, guys.
If you ever find yourself in trouble and need something, remember to call Dawn Roop. She's the best giver. People don't forget. Hey, will you join me in a word of prayer before we get started? Heavenly Father, will you again open up our hearts, our minds, our ears to really receive your word? And Lord, this is a week where we are again going to struggle with it, maybe a little bit. Maybe a lot, but Lord, humble us and remind us of your goodness so that we can be generous people as well. Bless us in this time in Jesus' name. Amen. All right. So as you heard, we're continuing our five-week red letter challenge here, and we're focusing on the fourth, right? Let's see. What do we have so far? Being. What was the second one? Forgiving, right? Serving last week. Now we have giving. And next week we'll have going. Let's stay at giving, right? I know I announced it at the beginning of the service, and I'm very, very pleasantly surprised that none of you had to take important business calls and leave before the sermon actually started, because this can be a difficult week. And I want to say, before we get started in all of this, and I'll get into this a little more later, as pastors, we have no idea who gives what, and we are completely unaffected by all of that. So, you know, if you give a little, we don't know, we don't treat you differently or look at you differently. You give a lot, we don't treat you differently or look at you differently. We have nothing to do with it. There's no such thing as a commission or anything like that. There's no such thing going on in this church. This is simply about teaching what God's word has to say of how we are to live our lives in regard to our giving, our generosity, and our finance. There's no personal motive, but I know there is, especially in the world, a lot of skepticism about the church and finance and everything like that. So having said that, let's go ahead and get into it. So out of all of the principles that we talk about in the Red Letter Challenge, giving actually is one that Jesus brings up most frequently. And it's also met with the widest reaction, right? Some people actually have the spiritual gift of giving. They love to give. If you need anything, they'll give immediately. They'll give a lot. They'll give always. And that's awesome. God blesses it. But not all of us are there, are we? But when we read through the words of Jesus himself, which we will in this coming week continue to do, by looking at the frequency in which he talks about money and giving and generosity, you start to realize that it is impossible to be a stingy Christian. It is impossible to be a greedy follower of Jesus. And this really isn't a gray issue in the scripture. To truly follow Jesus, to exemplify Jesus to the world, it means that you are generous just as he is generous. And so we see that Jesus talked more about generosity and giving than he did about love or heaven or hell. In fact, the only thing that he talks more about is the topic of the kingdom of God itself. And we don't think of Jesus talking about money so much, do we? But why would he? Well, because Jesus knows that we desperately need wisdom when it comes to our finances. The majority of us, about 80%, are living paycheck to paycheck, and about 70 at least are in some form of debt at all times, between credit cards or car loans or student loans, whatever it may be. Another study found that money is, you may have heard this, you may have even experienced this, money is the one thing that people argue about most in their marriages. And so no matter who you are, when it comes to saving or giving or managing money or even having an appropriate relationship with money is probably a challenge. And that's okay. We're all human. It's understandable. But with all that being said, let me share something with you that maybe you've heard it before, maybe you haven't, maybe it'll surprise you at first, but as you think about it, not as much. You are all rich. We are all rich. And I don't mean this in some metaphorical sense. We genuinely are a very wealthy people. According to the statistics, if you make $40,000 a year, you are in the top 4% of earners in the entire world. And if you make over $48,000 a year, you are in the top 1% of earners in the whole world. And we don't think about that a lot, but it's true. And of course, we have a higher cost of living and everything like that, but we are still the richest people in the world. And we enjoy a quality of life that few people in history have ever experienced or even dreamed of. And to go to show, our biggest fear is not starvation in this country. Our biggest fear is that, you know, a worry is that we eat too much, we have too much, and we consume in excess all the time. You know, we often think that if we could just make a little more, though, we would be happier, we would be more content. But we're not. No matter how many raises we get or how much money we should stumble upon, we're just never quite there, are we? When you look at the data, again, it shows us that the more money American people make, the less generous they tend to become. The less money they give away, which is odd, right? They're less generous than those people who are in the middle class or those who are poor or in the lower class. It seems kind of off. But we think that, well, maybe we are that group of people who become less generous the more wealthy we are. Now, think of all the stuff that you have in your house, in your apartment. I'm certainly a victim of this as well. I constantly have to sort through things because we're running out of space. But you've got multiple closets in your homes, probably one for each person. Maybe it's even a walk-in. But what happens when those closets for clothing and storage and everything fill up and you can't really stack things along the walls anymore? Well, maybe you put it in the garage, but then what happens when the garage is full and there's no place left to go? What do? You get a storage unit, right? The storage unit business is one of the biggest booming businesses at the moment in our country. People have so much stuff. They don't want to get rid of stuff. They want to keep buying stuff. And so off into the storage unit we go. Our priorities are kind of off, aren't they? And no matter how we've gotten here, we know that this isn't quite how it's supposed to be, right? When we care more about the stuff that we've accumulated and caring more about keeping that stuff and getting even more stuff, even though we don't even need it, more so about helping those who are in need, well, then we're kind of off, right? If we care more about making money than we do spending time with our families, that's not right. And if we are just consumed in checking our bank accounts and worrying how much is in and going out and all of that, and we're placing our security in our finances rather than in God, something is off yet again. But you know what's crazy? Money in and of itself is not bad, nor is it good. Money is not a sentient being that's out to get us. It is amoral. The problem is what we do with it, how we handle it, our relationship, our desire, our love for money that is that cause of evil. And so we ask again, why does Jesus talk about giving so much? Well, because Jesus knows that this was going to be and is going to continue to be a constant struggle for us. And anytime a pastor talks about money or giving, there's a lot of skepticism. There's a lot of cynicism. And it's probably for two main reasons. The first is because people don't like how their hard-earned dollars, right? Their hard-earned dollars are being used by the church. And they've seen Christians or churches or people under the name of Jesus use it in ways that haven't honored God. So why should you give? And the second one, the second reason that people don't like to talk about money in church or hear about money in church is that money is probably the number one idol in our lives. And for those of you who are not quite familiar with the term, an idol is a false god. It is anyone or anything that we place before God, that we desire above God, or that we trust in instead of God. And the human heart is an idol-making factory. If it's not one thing, it's the other, but it's probably both. And money is really high up there for our idols. Now, we like our things, and we like, you know, collecting and building our kingdoms in this world and being established and safe and know that we're taken care of. But it's, you know, hard for a lot of people for that reason to talk about money because it's so personal. Now, Jesus likely spoke about money more than anything else because money has become our security. It's become our hope. As long as we have enough, we'll be okay. Does that ring any bells in your mind? Have you ever thought that? Have you ever said that? I have, sinfully so. Now, it's one thing to come to church every Sunday. There's nothing bad. It's very good, in fact. But it's a whole other thing to actually trust Jesus fully and to have him actually be your security when you leave church and you continue on with your life as usual, to have him as your cornerstone, as your hope for the future, the one you rely on. Remember, we talked in the first week, the one that you build on, like the wise builder. Now, few things say that you trust Jesus with your present and your future, like living a life of radical generosity. Now, Jesus is passionate about generosity and about giving because Jesus is passionate about you. Now, again, different people will struggle with different things, but every single one of us is given the opportunity to make decisions with our money, right? You've heard the term, we vote with our dollars. I know many of you stop buying from certain brands if you have a disagreement with them. I know many of you probably give to politicians if you like them or endorse them, but do we invest our money in the same way towards God's kingdom? If someone went to look, not me, again, I can't stress this enough, if someone were to look at your bank account or your credit card statement and see how you spent your money, maybe that person is you, right? Or would a person who's looking at that be able to tell that you are a follower of Jesus in any way? Now, there's an incredible story that we just read in Luke about a generous woman who had just lost her husband. And when you're a widow in those times, you are not doing well financially. That's why there are so many calls in the scripture to take care of widows. But this woman continued to live a life of generosity. It says, Jesus looked up and he saw the rich putting their gifts into the treasury. And he also saw a poor widow put in two very small copper coins. Truly, I tell you, Jesus said, this poor widow has put in more than all the others. All these people gave gifts out of their wealth, but she, out of her poverty, put in all that she has to live on. Now, according to our currency today, this woman gave about a little less than half a penny, right? Now, there's no way that she could outgive everyone or even anyone probably in the congregation that day. And, you know, to go the other way, Jesus is not against big gifts or large donations. He doesn't condemn the Pharisees and the other people for their large gifts. But he does highlight the sacrifice that it took from this woman to give in this way. It shows us that God welcomes a life of sacrificial generosity because that's what one of the things that really shows where your faith and your trust lie. Now, because everyone else around you in this world is probably using money and trusting in it and building their own little kingdoms and accumulating their stuff and making sure they're safe in the future. Just because everyone else is doing that doesn't mean it's right for us as Christians to do that. We are not exactly like the world. We're different. And that's what makes us stand out and look like Jesus to the world, remember? Now, that's not to say that we're against having things or against prosperity or that God wants you to be broke all the time. No, no. God provides for us richly. That's okay. There's nothing wrong with that. But the point that we're trying to make is that you can't really be all in for God and fully trust and fully be on the mission if you don't trust God with your money. Now, again, we're talking about laying down our biggest idol and surrendering it to Jesus. And pun intended, putting our money where our mouth is, right? If we say that we believe and we trust and we hope, but it's not the money though, right? Again, that's a problem. And Jesus says, where your treasure is, there your heart is. Now, a little personal story of my relationship with tithing. When I was in high school, college, seminary, tithing was awesome, right? I had a perfect track record of tithing, and I always gave the appropriate amount because I never earned any money. So, you know, 10% of nothing is nothing, but I was paying to go to school, so maybe God can kick me back some money. No, that's not how it works at all. That's not how it works, and we'll talk about God's generosity in a little bit. But so then I started at St. Matthew. And, I'm making money now, real money. First, like, real job ever. And all of a sudden these paychecks are coming in. I go, oh my gosh, that is really nice. Have you heard of these paychecks? Right? It was good. But then, you crunch the numbers. Oh my gosh, it's that much? 10% looks like that. Once you see the number, and then, knowing how much it is, that's one thing. But then giving it, right? Here, you take it. And your thumbs are keep pressing, right? No, God, really, you have it. It was hard. It was really hard. There's this act of relinquishing, of okay, of trust, of actual sacrifice. And sinfully so, it was uncomfortable. It was okay. I've lacked nothing ever, including in the time that I started giving. God provides always, now, tomorrow, for any need that we have in body and soul, and God provides for us into eternity. There's no doubt. I used to dread even the idea of preaching on giving because I was always a person who didn't give and, oh, I don't know. And how I don't know even what it's like and how will people respond to it, but I love giving. Every single week or month I do online, but it brings you back and it puts you in the state of actively depending on God. And you could think, oh, I could do this. I could do that. I could pay off this. I could. Nope. Trust God with it. And God hasn't failed me yet. And he hasn't failed you yet. I can't imagine. And he will not fail us. Now, here's one of the good things about being generous, especially when it comes to finances, right? We think, oh, what could I do with that money? God sends your money places that you can't ever go. And God uses your money in ways that you could never accomplish or that you ever even knew were possible. God does that. You just trust him with it. And our trust is in good hands with him. Now, if you aren't a regular giver, if you don't tithe, we want to challenge you. And this isn't just me. This is God challenging you as well and encouraging you to do that. Now, in fact, as we go on this week, the Red Letter Challenge, the study, the workbook, will challenge you and grow you and educate you to be a more generous person, both toward God's church and God's people and the people of this world as well. And I hope that this isn't the week where you go, maybe I'll skip it or I'll catch up on it. I know it's going to be uncomfortable. This is not about me and you or anything. This is about your relationship with God and becoming a follower of Jesus. And I want to make it really explicit. God does not love you more the more you give. Your salvation is in no way, shape, or form ever dependent on how much you give. Your salvation, your freedom, your hope, joy, and peace are what Jesus did for you on the cross. This is not about being good enough or proving ourselves. This is about a joyful response to how much God has given us already, right? All this money, everything that God has said, hey, you can hold this for me. It's all God's anyway, but trusting God enough to be able to relinquish and trust him with our hard-earned money. That's not to say you don't work hard, but it is all from God. It always has been. It always will be. So I hope you don't stop short. And it's great to serve and to be the hands and feet and to be active. And all of that is included in a generosity. But we also have to address and work through and engage in sacrificial generosity. Now, God in our first scripture today, he challenges you to the same. And this is the only time where God says, hey, test me, right? Usually testing God is not a good idea, and I wouldn't recommend it. But let's see how this one shapes out, right? God says, bring the whole tithe into the storehouse that there may be food in my house. Test me in this, says the Lord Almighty, and see if I will not throw open the floodgates of heaven and pour out so much blessing that there will not be enough room to store it. It's okay to take God's word on that. And we don't give so that we can receive back, but we just trust that God will take care of us, right? In Matthew 23, Jesus tells his followers not to neglect the tithe. And if in the Old Testament we gave out of obedience to the law, well, then how much in being shaped by the gospel should we give after being changed by the grace of Jesus? What does that look like for you in a practical way today? Well, it's really easy to see once you kind of start a budget where your money, you know, and you look at it and you see where your money goes and what you're doing, what you're invested in, what you care about. And I want you to encourage you to look at your budget, see where all that is, and see, well, are you really making God a priority in all this? Is God moving you? Is he stirring your heart in any way? And really invest in a sacrificial and generous way and make any changes if God calls you to do that. And again, that's going to hurt a little bit. My wife actually told me this great C.S. Lewis quote in which he says, well, what's the rule and how we ought to give? And he says, well, you know, the best thing that I can come up with is that we should always give more than we think we can. Right? If your life reflects all of the luxuries and the amenities and the activities as anyone else in the world and people who compare with your income level and anything like that, well, you're probably not giving enough. Or if you are giving in a way, but not in a way that really has you curb back on anything, give up on anything for the sake of your giving, and you're not really feeling a sacrifice in anything, well, that's probably too little as well. But knowing that we're provided for in everything, in every need, in Jesus all the time, gives us this freedom to be radically generous and to let God worry about the rest with it. Now, just as we serve out of a response to God, we give because God first gave to us. And of course, most famously, we read about that in John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only son. Think about the generosity that that takes, so that whoever would believe in him would not perish, but have eternal life. God showed his love for us, his generosity, by giving us his son. And Jesus showed his generosity by giving up his perfect life. And when we give, we reflect the heart and the character of God to those around us, strengthening our brothers and sisters in Christ, and to the world who would never know this kind of generosity outside of God's people. Our God is a giver. And when we start living a life of giving, our biggest reward will be the fact that we take on the very nature of our awesome God and our awesome King Jesus. There's few things I can think of that are greater than being transformed into the image of Jesus, even when it comes to something like giving and letting the world see him through our generosity and the kingdom being built up as a result of that. So having said that, will you pray with me? Heavenly Father, this is a tough one for us. And we pray that you would encourage us by your word. You would encourage us continuing in this week to lay down all of our idols, including that of money. Trust in you. But Lord, as always, we pray, we can't do this by our own strength. And some of us, maybe many of us, if we're being honest, don't really even want to do it. We pray that you would break through in our hearts and change us and shape us to be more like you in every single way. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Having heard God's word, I invite you all to join me in standing. We'll have a time of confession followed by a word of forgiveness. And this is a time where we get to come before God, and week after week, we get to reflect and hear and acknowledge that we've fallen short of God's perfect will, his desire for our lives. And it doesn't feel really good, does it? Knowing that we have a perfectly generous God, and yet we just withhold all the time. We refuse. We go in different directions. And, well, what's God going to do with us? Well, God tells us, bring it all to me. Let me have it. I sent my son to die for you so that in faith, in your confession, you can be forgiven, clean, righteous, blameless, and all of it. So we come here to do that. Every week, God's mercy is new. And as we confess, we trust in it. We hope in it. And we know
that our Father is good, and through Jesus Christ will give it to us. So I invite you to join me for a time of confession, and I will lead us in prayer. We'll have a moment of silence and then a word of forgiveness after that. God, you are so good to us. You are so great, so magnificent, so amazing, not only in your power and your splendor, but God, in your love. God, you don't have to love us. People who are sinful, who are broken, people who don't match up to you in any way, shape, or form, but yet you do. You see us, and you are so humble. You engage in relationship with us, and you provide everything that we need all of the time. And yet, God, we're so quick to look to other things, whether it's status or power or sex or money or whatever it should be, God, as a security, as something that we desire more than you. Lord, help us not to turn away from you anymore, but to embrace you, knowing that it's your generosity that makes us whole. And as we continue to be shaped by your Holy Spirit, and as we continue to become more whole, that we become people who are generous as well. But God, any sin that we have in our lives, any regret, any fear, any failure, Lord, help us now to lay it at the foot of your cross and to truly surrender it, knowing that you've taken care of it by your Son's death and resurrection. Lord, we lay that before you now. True generosity has never been more apparent or more perfect or visible than when God sent Jesus Christ to die for us and to be raised again. And this is what generosity is. And so as you hear these words, receive it, be aware of it, be thankful for it, and go out as God's redeemed people to serve him faithfully. You are forgiven. In the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen. We sing. Thank you.
myself to thee. Fill me with thy love and power. Let thy blessing fall on me. I surrender all. I surrender all to thee, my blessed Savior. I surrender all. And I surrender all. I surrender to thee, my blessed Savior, I surrender all.
Seated. Before we receive the offering, we just have a few couple announcements. We want to thank you for your continued generosity, of course, through the season of the pandemic into today, and for a lot of you way before that as well. As God is leading you to give, know that you can give in person, online, you can mail it in. If you have any questions about that or you're interested in online giving, you can always visit our website at st-matthew.org/give. And here's a note that I've made before. You know, I talked in my sermon about that active, you know, relinquishing part. And one of the things about the online giving, I've been doing it ever since I started here because it's so convenient and I never forget. But I also have to be active that it doesn't become a passive thing that I do. I want it to be active. And so during the time that the offering is received, I still like to pray to God in a kind of an active surrender and say, God, I trust you. Use this in your kingdom. Maybe that would be beneficial for you as well if you give online. As always, the communication cards are in front of you in the pews. Go ahead and fill those out. Let us know that you're here. Any questions, comments, prayer requests, let us know. If you need something, let us know too. We'll get in touch with you right away. And then Bible classes are continuing at 10 a.m. We really hope for you to be there, and we expect you to be there as well as God's people of the church. And so for all age groups, we've got something on Sunday morning. We'll see you then. Having said that, let's see, we've got, as we collect the offering, there's going to be a video for us from our Mission of the Month, Franklin Avenue, and they're going to tell you all what they're about, so go ahead and look at the screen.
What is the importance of the gospel? The gospel is the power of God to break the chains of sin. And the chain of sin is basically in all of our lives. You remember when they caught the woman in the act of adultery, and they brought her to Jesus and said, Moses in the law said she should be stoned to death. What do you say, Jesus? And Jesus said to them, you who are without sin, cast the first stone. And they all walked away. Why? Because we are all sinners. And the gospel needs to be proclaimed to all of us, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. The gospel tells us how God deals with us. It reveals God's righteousness. Paul says in the small catechism, when he talks about baptism, I think it's the second question. He says, what does baptism, what's the power of baptism? It forgives us of our sins. It delivers us from death and the devil, and it gives us eternal life. That's the gospel. The gospel forgives us, delivers us, and gives us eternal life. The reason that the Flint Mission Network is so important, because there are a lot of people who've been left behind in these communities, and even among some of our congregations. And they need to know that Jesus loves them. And sometimes the best way of doing that is to create a mission society that can serve people in community. That is why the Flint Mission Network is so important. My prayer is that as they continue to include more congregations and more areas of the city of Flint into this network, that many people who've been left behind will come to hear the good news of the gospel. May Jesus be proclaimed. Amen.
The Flint Mission Network is a community of four ministries gathered around the ideas of proclaiming the gospel, empowering our neighbors, and lifting one another up within the city of Flint. Its four members are Franklin Avenue Mission, who proclaim the gospel and bring warm, nutritious meals to Flint's east side. Mercy House, which is a transitional housing facility for mothers and children struggling with homelessness that operates in partnership with Wellspring Lutheran Services. the Luke Clinic, which is a free pre and antenatal care clinic for expecting mothers and infants that is operated in partnership with the University of Michigan Hospital. And now we introduce York Avenue Mission, which is being planted here at Our Savior Lutheran Church on Flint's north side. I want to invite you to come and join as we publicly launch the Flint Mission Network on Reformation Day, Sunday, October 31st. We are going to celebrate here at Our Savior Lutheran Church at 10:30 a.m. Or you can come and join us at Franklin Avenue Mission at 4 o'clock in the afternoon, where we'll have a fellowship meal afterwards as well. Finally, I want to encourage you to accept this invitation to become part of the Flint Mission Network as we continue to grow and serve as the hands, the feet, the face, and the voice of Jesus within the city of Flint.
The church is one foundation, is Jesus Christ the Lord. She is his new creation by water.
Incredible, the work that they're doing over there. Also, Thomas, why don't we do that version of the song in worship? I like that. It's got a bump to it. Hey, get your voice a little higher, all right? If you are interested in taking any next steps with our Mission of the Month, go visit them at their website and how you can be active and how you can support them. Amazing to see God working through them in so many different ways. It's truly, truly impressive. The only other announcement that we have is my microphone on, by the way? Okay, good. You never know up here. So the only other announcement is that, again, guests, if you have any questions about what we do here, what we believe, or anything else, please come see me after service or email us at hello@st-matthew.org or call our front office. We'll be happy to help and answer any questions, pray with you, whatever you need. So having said that, I invite you to stand as we lift up our prayers to our Father in heaven. Dear Lord, we want to thank you for the blessing that the Red Letter Challenge has been so far, and we want to pray that you would continue to bless us in our faith as a church, that you would bless our community through it as you shape us to go into it and represent you. Lord, be powerful at work in our hearts. Lord, we pray for guidance in filling vacant staff positions here at St. Matthew. And again, Lord, we trust you with that process, and we know that your timing isn't our timing. So help us to not only humor your will and your timing, but to rejoice in it and to trust in it as well. Lord, we pray for persecuted Christians around the world. And today we lift up specifically our brothers and sisters in Vietnam. Give them a rest from their persecution, but most of all, help them to stand firm in the name of Jesus Christ. We pray for Kathleen Schwartha, one of our homebound members, Lord, and we pray that you would continue to be with her and guide her and bless her and draw near to her and cause her to draw near to you in faith. Lord, help us as well as her brothers and sisters to reach out and provide any sort of need that she has, whether it's through friendship or prayer, reading of the scripture, whatever it should be, Lord. We pray for the work of the Franklin Avenue Mission in Flint. You have clearly, Lord, called and blessed our brothers and sisters up there to do your work. And Lord, let it not fail if it is of your will. Guide them. And Lord, help us to help them as well and work through us to be a blessing to them. We pray for the advancement of your kingdom, Lord, continuing despite the pandemic. Lord, you are bigger than all of this. Remind us of that, Lord, and reach those people who need you, God. We pray for our governors everywhere, but especially our governor in Michigan. Lord, guide her, lead her, help her to see what is just always and do what is right, not in the sight of man, not in her own sight, but in yours, God. Everybody struggles with that, and we need you. So, Lord, would you work in her heart as you do with all of us? Lord, we pray for those who are sick or hospitalized, those who are suffering, including Randy Tyler, Mike Yannissey, for Dawn Roop's mother, for Paul, the brother of John Daugherty, for one of Don Roop's friends, for Mike. Lord, we pray also for protection for those who currently have COVID or are struggling with the aftermath of COVID. And Lord, we ask that you would give protection to those who are near COVID and susceptible to it. But Lord, for all of them, bless them and heal them in mind and body and soul as well. Make them whole as only you can. And in the meantime, and always help them to trust in Jesus. And Lord, we know that you are our security and you will take care of us always. Lord, we pray that your people would have faith. Actually, Lord, that this whole world would have faith instead of fear. There is so much to worry about in these times. And honestly, Lord, for good reason. But Lord, would you help us to not have fear or worry overshadow the confidence that we have in you? Lord, we also want to pray for those who have suffered loss recently. Lord, we pray for the family and friends of former St. Matthew teacher Gary Markshausen. Lord, be with them, bind up their broken hearts, and help them to remember the joy that we have in the resurrection that is to come for those who depart in the faith. But Lord, all of these prayers that we have, Lord, we have so much more that we know about and that we don't even know about. But you know, God, and you will take care of us. But Lord, everything now we lift up to you in the name of our King Jesus. And we're going to pray the words that he taught us to pray, but we'll sing them today. So Lord, hear our song. Remember that all of the Christian life flows out of being with God, right? So be with God, remain in his word, and be reminded always of the generosity that he has shown you so that you can know that he can work through you to be generous in this life and in this world. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you his peace. Amen.